Public comments, submittal process for this teleconference meeting?
Yes, I'll read the public notice. This meeting is being conducted utilizing teleconferencing and electronic means consistent with State of California Executive Order N-29-20 dated March 17, 2020 regarding the COVID-19 pandemic. Planning commissioners and staff who have joined the meeting, please mute your microphones and unmute when called upon and acknowledged by the chairperson. Submission of public comment procedures in accordance with Executive Order N-29-20 and based on guidance from the California Department of Public Health. In order to minimize the spread of COVID-19 virus, city meetings may be observed live at https://salinas.registrar.com/calendar.aspx. On the Salinas channel on YouTube at https://www.youtube.com/user/the Salinas channel. Advance submittal of public comments via email were due today at 1:30 p.m. to the Planning Commission Secretary at publiccomments.cd@ci.salinas.ca.us. If you are watching the live stream and wish to make either a general public comment or to comment on a specific agenda item as it is being heard, please join the Zoom webinar at https://zoom.us/j/93537442397 or join by telephone at 1-669-900-6833. The webinar ID is 972-1716-0760. You may also submit your written comment limited to 250 words or less via emails to the Planning Commission Secretary at publiccomments.cd@ci.salinas.ca.us. Every effort will be made to read your comment into the record, but some comments may not be read due to time limitations. Comments received via email shall be read, provided that the reading shall not exceed 2 minutes.
Thank you, Myra. The meeting is now officially called to order, and we will recite the Pledge of Allegiance. And I will lead you in that. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Okay, Myra, can we have a roll call, please?
Commissioner Donahue?
Present.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Present.
Commissioner Monzo?
Present.
Commissioner North?
Present.
Chairperson Meeks?
Present.
And Commissioner Griffin will be absent, and Jill Lutz is just joining us now.
Okay. Now we'll proceed with the welcome and staff introductions, and also the introduction of the city manager.
Why don't we proceed with welcome and introduction to new city manager, Stephen Kerrigan, first.
Works for me. Appreciate it. Thank you for allowing me a few minutes just to say hello. Normally I would do this in person. It's still kind of awkward, but it's a pleasure to meet all of you. Liz Soto from the city manager's office is scheduling meetings and coffees and things, so she'll be reaching out to you to find out the best way to just do one-on-ones, whether it's Zoom or in a large conference room. I'll out my new friend Dennis Donahue here. We had a chance earlier today to meet in a large conference room, and it was nice. It was a chance just to get started. So this is my fourth week. Everybody at City Hall has been very accommodating. The community's been great. That phrase, drinking from a fire hose, it is true. I'm looking forward to getting the introductions out of the way, and really, I'm enjoying the work. But there's still a lot of people to meet and a lot of facilities to tour. I'm really enjoying myself. I did move here. That was a question. That was probably the most popular question I got when I started. Not are you moving here, but did you really move here? And it's like, yes, I did. I'm really happy to say that I'm really enjoying my time here. Everything's an adventure, but The most important thing is I'm looking forward to meeting each one of you, getting to know you on a personal level, on a professional level, hearing more about your backgrounds. And then I will attend a planning commission every now and then. And I'm not doing it to check on you. It's just I'm kind of geekish that way, where I'll see something that maybe you'll say there's no reason why you should be here. I like sitting in the back row and hearing some of these things. So don't be surprised if you see me once we get back to in person or some of these Zoom meetings, just checking in. I like the work. So thank you. And like I said, Liz will be reaching out to each one of you just to let her know what works best for you. And I look forward to getting to know each one of you. So thank you.
Welcome, Mr. Kerrigan.
Thank you. Steve, please.
Okay. Now can we have the staff introductions?
Sure, I'll go first. Courtney Grossman, Planning Manager, Current Planning.
I'm Megan Hunter, Community Development Director.
Chris Callahan, City Attorney.
Myra Flores, Administrative Aid.
Bobby Latino, Associate Planner.
Okay. Email on items that are not on the agenda. Are there any, Myra?
No comments were received.
Okay, thank you. Okay, consent item 21-048, approval of the minutes from the January 2021 meeting. Are there any questions or comments from the commissioners? Commissioner Donahue. I see you shaking your head.
Yeah, no questions. I'm fine.
Okay. Commissioner Gonzalez?
None.
Commissioner Roots?
No questions.
Commissioner Manzo?
No questions or comments.
Commissioner Knorr?
No questions or comments.
And I have no questions. Is there a motion?
Move approval.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, so with a motion by Commissioner Lutz and a second by Commissioner Manzo, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Donahue?
Approved.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Yes.
Commissioner Lutz?
Aye.
Commissioner Manzo?
Aye.
Commissioner Knorr?
Yes.
Chairperson Meeks?
Yes. Okay, moving on. Item number 21-041, a conditional use permit 2020-001, request for residential design review to convert 965 square feet of existing 1099 attic into a second story addition within an existing single family dwelling unit located at 1054 University Avenue. In R-L-5.5 residential low density zoning district. And Courtney will present the presentation.
Thank you, Chair Meeks, members of the Planning Commission. I think we've seen this project a couple times before, so I'm not going to go too deep into the presentation again. But this is a conditional use permit for what we call residential design review. It was an attic that was constructed without permits, and a code enforcement case ensued. An application for the CUP was submitted, and this is the project. Next slide, please. The photo at the top shows the existing house prior to the attic addition project, and the photo below shows the completed project. The owners, as I mentioned before, converted the attic into a second story without approvals. A code case was created, and this requires a conditional use permit. Normally, a conditional use permit is submitted before the project is constructed. Next slide. The project location is on University Avenue at 1054. When the item went to the Planning Commission back in November, there was a letter of opposition from Mrs. Shagnon. The letter indicated concerns about the project. At the hearing in November, the Planning Commission asked the applicant to reduce the bulk of the second floor. There were two other requests, one to seal off the attic space above and apply a louvered or a frosted treatment to the windows to provide privacy from the second floor to the neighbor's yards. Next slide, please. At the November 18th meeting, the Planning Commission received plans that, for the most part, responded to the Planning Commission's request to modify the elevation to become compliant. In this particular application, however, there was a, I think, a second thought from the applicant. The applicant noted that it would cost $80,000 to fix the house to provide compliance with the zoning regulations, and the applicant requested reconsideration. So in turn, the Planning Commission continued to allow the applicant to further study options that would address articulation opportunities on the front building elevation. Next slide. At the next meeting, the Planning Commission continued, and I'm going to get a little bit confused here. There were a couple of meetings. It went to December 16 and then on to January 20th. And then I believe it was continued to this meeting directly. And we have to be careful because the Permit Streamlining Act has a final action requirement coming up on February 22nd. This already has a 90-day extension, so we're running out of timing to take final action on this item. Next slide. The plans were submitted to the to the city from the applicant on January 21. The Planning Commission may recall there were multiple plan sets submitted over the course of the of this. Set of hearings. One set of plans included ivy or some sort of plant material applied to the front of the upper story. There were some other design proposals. In this case, the January 21 plans, essentially from what we can tell, include the addition of two posts, which are located underneath the existing awning at the front door. And I'm not sure if the cursor could point to the two posts right at the front door. Thank you. There's one. There's the other. These posts are constructed from copper. Staff has reviewed this proposal and recommends that this does not meet the Planning Commission's direction of reducing the upper story bulk. It doesn't provide the articulation that's required by the zoning code. And for this reason, staff is not recommending approval. Next slide, please. It doesn't meet the infill residential requirements for the following reasons, A through F. The height in the scale is disproportionate in size and overwhelms the existing residential block face. And this photo, I think, is taken from Google Street View. The size of the home, when looking at the neighbors, you can have the ability to see the disproportionate in size issue. The proposed roof line, the mass, and the lack of architectural projections along the street facade doesn't maintain the similar horizontal and vertical proportions of adjacent facades. The design is supposed to provide a harmonious transition of new development and existing development. In this case, the staff recommendation is that it doesn't provide that harmonious transition. The second floor is supposed to have a step back design from the street and be broken into smaller components. In this particular case, the addition created a vertical face in the front that goes straight from the lower floor to the upper peak of the roof with no setback. And I can't quite see the rest of it, but I believe it should be visible on your screen. These are the zoning code requirements for infill. Yeah, next slide, please. In terms of the California Environmental Quality Act, it's exempt. The addition is less than 50% of the floor area of the existing unit. Next slide. In conclusion, the proposal doesn't meet the zoning code requirements. It's actually inconsistent with the general plan because it doesn't conform with the design element, policy CD 2.3, which requires that infill development be consistent with the scale and character of existing neighborhoods. The second story addition is not compatible with adjacent properties, doesn't follow the context of the neighborhood block face. It does not preserve and reinforce the character of the established streetscape by maintaining similar horizontal and vertical proportions. For these reasons, the staff recommends that not only does it not meet the zoning code of the general plan, it doesn't satisfy and follow the direction provided by Planning Commission in previous meetings. The resolution provided to the commission in the packet shows a denial, and that is staff's recommendation. Staff's available for questions. This is the end of the presentation.
Thank you, Courtney. Are there any questions from the commissioners to Courtney regarding this presentation? Commissioner Donahue?
Yeah, I have a number of questions. First of all, you mentioned this expiration on February 22nd in terms of streamlining permit. Question number one, whatever we decide today, is this appealable? Are we the end of the line? What are the consequences of our decision? That's number one. And then number two, just like last time when we were talking about, approving three houses, the council had previously made the policy call, and the role of the Planning Commission was to just simply say, hey, city, your mitigation recommendations aren't good enough. What exactly is our level of responsibility here? That's number one. I got to tell you, every time I look about this and think about it, it still remains really thorny in my mind mentally. And because now I want to talk about our articulation, if you look at the picture of before and after, my question is, how does somebody add a second story? They just do it. Or is the issue facing and this and that? Because having done that, $80,000 is a fair chunk of change. So the question to my mind, this having gone this far, and yes, the rest of the second story is visible when you go for a walk, because I walked by it again the other day. To me, at this point, the sole issue, because I have a tough time signing up for an $80,000 hit, not being quite clear where all the enablers are here. But the question the real issue at this point is privacy for neighbors, as opposed to the particulars. Of the code, because for whatever reason, the genie got out of the bottle on this one. And again, I remain not completely clear on it. So what's our jurisdiction really? Regardless of, does it end here? Can it go to council if they don't like it? Because if this idea of dropping, baby McMansions into neighborhoods, which has been done before, that begins to kind of smack of me of a policy call, in which case, I want to do my job as a commissioner here, but this ultimately, if you know, if we need the wisdom of Solomon, then this needs to go to council in my view. So I kind of want to understand what our role is here, specifically, and then I'm just, unless you can tell me otherwise, I understand all the particulars you laid out, but to me, this is all about preserving privacy for the neighbors, and that's got to be the primary consideration. I'm not going to sign up for telling someone you got to spend 80 grand because I just don't know how the heck somebody builds a second floor and nobody notices. So those are my questions or comments or both.
So in terms of decision making, any decision by the Planning Commission would be appealable to the council within 10 days. So if the commission were to approve it and a neighbor is aggrieved, they could appeal. If the planning commission turns the CUP down, then the applicant could appeal within 10 days and then the matter goes to the city council.
And the reason I ask that, if technically we have to verify it's out of compliance. It is out of compliance. And then, as I say, it might be my personal opinion. Hey, I don't think they should get hit for 80 grand, but because of the nature of this thing, it seems to me the ultimate resolution has to now move towards the council because that, to me, it begins to kind of border on a policy consideration, you know, because I went for another walk. I like to walk, these days. And I was absolutely startled where I saw a new second floor, but I'm not going to name names or name streets. So apparently it's going on. And it didn't make any sense to me. And you know, but so, I mean, I don't have a problem saying, look, it is my responsibility to specifically say this is out of compliance in my personal opinion. It's my personal opinion. If my role is to say it's out of compliance, I'll say that. But on the other hand, when you sit on the council or in the mayor's chair, you do want to know what this body thinks. And I'll just go on record as saying I think an 80K remedy is too obsessive, and privacy now needs to be the issue for the neighbors. But that would be my thought. But again, if you can kind of explain this, because if I understand it, 80 grand is, I mean, what are you eliminating the whole second floor? Or are you just moving something back? I mean, for the sake of Ivy, I'm still not clear what the recommendation is that causes 80 grand.
Yeah, well, the 80 grand was an estimate provided by the applicant.
And is it basically just get rid of the second, just knock all the stuff out and it's back to the way it was?
I probably defer that to the applicant's team. I think they'll have an opportunity to speak on this matter, but
okay.
there was some considerations given that cost, and part of it could have been move out cost and temporary housing. But I'd like the applicant to answer.
How okay. Got All right. Money. That's fair enough.
Courtney,
I'll wait.
Courtney, if I can weigh in, the way that the 80 grand came about is that the applicant provided an alternative design to help mitigate the massing. And the staff recommendation back, I think it was on November 18th, was to approve with that modification. And then they actually withdrew the plan and stated themselves that it would be 80 grand to execute the plan that they had submitted and that we were inclined to recommend approval for. Actually, we had it in the system as a recommendation of approval. So that's
and that's what I'm trying to wrap my head around, because if you walk by, I mean, who cares if you move something back a little bit? There's still a whole second floor there. I mean, every time I walk by, I went to, this is probably a bad analogy, but I went to Sacred Heart Church as a kid. It's like, holy cow, that looks like the church. You know, it's big and it's two stories. And you're looking at the front, you know, trust me when I tell you, people are looking at the side and the back of this thing too. You know, so to me, it's kind of like, what's the deal here, really? Is it just get to an acceptable number for some sort of mitigation, or are we talking about getting rid of the second floor? You know, because ultimately, you got a baby McMansion in the middle of the neighborhood, and if that needs to be put in the council's hands, so be it. Or you, Megan, you're basically implying possibly there's a solution everybody could live with, in which case, if there is, you know, and I know we run out of time till February 22nd, but if they don't want to spend 80 grand, then they should figure out a solution by February 22nd.
Yeah, I think what we're not saying what it should be. We still have to make findings based on what the code says. And I think what we were stating to the applicant is it doesn't necessarily have to cost you 80 grand. There are ways that you can help address massing. But what was put forward to us based on that, it was, you know, that's why the staff recommendation.
Well, this would be my final comment. Steve Haven outed me. We had lunch. I told Steve, he happened to have my very favorite city attorney on his staff, but and I know everybody knows chapter and verse, but trust me, I'm pretty sure this is not in the code. To me, this is legalese for how do you get out of Dodge, as opposed to either that or I want to kick it to the council. But we've just ended up in this place of, look, how do we fix this and move on with some level of consistency in my mind. But I won't say any more, and I'll wait to hear it, and then I'll vote accordingly.
And just to answer the second part of your question was about the Planning Commission's role. The Planning Commission's role is to establish findings, which are the basis for your decision. In the resolution referenced in the staff report, there are findings that staff has prepared that explain why the project does not meet the zoning standards, which support the decision of denial. Should the commission decide that a approval is in order, then the commission would need to prepare or provide the rationale and the findings as to how approval would be supported.
I'm comfortable with your findings. I'm just not comfortable with the remedy at the moment, or what seems to be the remedy. So
it's anyway. Not an ideal situation.
No, that's a fair comment.
Commissioner Gonzalez, any questions for?
Yeah. Thank you. as I recall, the bulk of the 80,000 had to do with demolishing the staircase that goes up to the attic that makes it more of a second story. That was one of the things that we were trying to avoid by pushing this back and giving the applicant an opportunity to work with the staff to create a different remedy. We found that the vines didn't quite work. And I believe Commissioner Knorr had suggested, what about an awning that helped to create that setback and minimize at least the look of the bulk? And so my question is, did the applicant work with staff? I see there's an awning, but it looks really small and it doesn't quite seem to meet what I was understanding Commissioner Knorr to be suggesting. And so to what extent did the applicant work with staff to find a good solution?
Sure. City staff met with the architect David Elliott, and the communication between staff and the architect was was favorable. I think the architect understood what the city was looking for. It appears that the architect was receiving direction from the owner, and that direction didn't lend itself to creating the compliance that the zoning code requires. And from what we can tell, that awning that has the post on it is the exact same awning that right now.
Thank you.
Commissioner Meeks, I think we're having a hard time hearing you.
Okay, I'll get closer. How's that?
Better.
Okay. I didn't know. Never mind. Commissioner Lutz, any questions for Courtney?
Yes, I have a few questions, if I could. Courtney, the modifications that were suggested to adequately resolve the zoning code violations for infill were, and it tried to write them down, to reduce the bulk, seal off two walls of the attic space, frost windows, a step back from the front wall, further articulation. But none of it was done, absolutely nothing. The only thing that the applicant did was put up two posts for the awning.
Actually, not exactly true. I believe the plans show the frosting of the windows, which is a film that's being applied to the glass to provide or to reduce clarity in the windows. And the attic walls, I believe in the latest plan set, include the removal of the drywall finishes upstairs so that it's an open attic upstairs.
And has that been done?
It's on the plan. The physical work hasn't occurred yet. That work would happen through a building permit process at the tail end of the outcome of this conditional use permit.
And Courtney, when the administrative permit was given for the attic space, I'm asking, this is a difficult question. When staff went and looked at it, did it seem large for an attic? Did it seem like the intent was to build a second story?
It was interesting. City staff received complaints from the neighborhood while it was under construction. Staff looked at the property, looked at the plans. It was a lot of lumber. It was a very large volume, and it was questionable what was actually being contemplated. But looking at the plans, it had a Jacob's ladder, which is a hatch to gain access to the upper area. Okay. There was no permanent usable staircase on the plans. So from a compliance standpoint, the plans clearly indicated it was an attic.
And so, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I don't want to go too far out on a limb here, but we could almost say that the intent of the applicant was to really build a second story.
It's a pretty big attic.
Pardon me?
It's a large attic.
So I asked this for a reason, because if the applicant was deliberately misleading the city, then that's a much more serious situation. And so when I think about Dennis talking about an $80,000 fix, if someone deliberately misled the city with the intention of saying to the city, I'm putting in an attic, but I'm going to build a second story when you're not looking, that's much more serious. And I'm very uncomfortable with what was going on here. Do you see where I'm going with that? I mean, in other words, this is a person that knew that you had to have a permit to build. And as Thomas Jefferson said, ignorance of the law is no excuse. So we can't claim that he didn't know. So I just feel like there was somebody was gaming the system. And it seems to me that if we approve the permit, then this will establish a precedent for the city, which is going to make it difficult to enforce future applications. Is that correct?
It is a large attic, and there's been some discussion on how to plug the hole of this, you know, perhaps happening in the future. One angle is to look at the zoning code carefully and perhaps add another requirement or another list of items that should be subject to a conditional use permit. And in other words, when houses are made taller, maybe a 10% height increase, or maybe, you know, some other quantitative rationale, a conditional use permit, even for a one-story house, could be required, and that might be a way to address this from happening in the future.
I think that's going to be important, because we can't have people all over the city flaunting our zoning codes. And so I don't suggest that we make them tear it down, but it seems to me if there was any type of trying to game the city or deliberately mislead the city, then an $80,000 fine, if you will, for fixing things seems legitimate to me. Okay, those were my questions, and I'll have comments later.
I did want to add that this second story hasn't gone through the building permit process. So, you know, presumably if it was built as an attic, they're going to have to make structural upgrades. Okay. And if it wasn't built as a second story, they might be able to permit it more easily through the building permit process. So I just wanted to say that regardless, they're still going to have to go through the building permit process, not only based on what the commission decides, but because the second story, that is non-habitable space in the minds of the building code.
Thank you, Megan. Thank you, John. I'll have comments later.
Chairperson Meeks, I think you said Commissioner Munsell, so I'm gonna go ahead. I think it's a follow-up question to what Commissioner Lutz was getting at. I'm just trying to understand the process of the city. If when they submitted sort of this upgrade to the attic, I guess my question is, are the dimensions that were submitted greater than what was actually built as an attic? Because you said that folks went to go check it out from city staff, right? And so I guess my question is, it's getting at the question that Commissioner Lutz was, whether or not it was misleading, right? When the plans were submitted, was there a certain size? And then when it was built, was it a different size?
I think the volume is the same size. And frankly, when we were there, there was no floor. It was just 2x4s. So it's really hard to tell, but I think the outer limits of the construction are the same. But usually attics, you know, they're not necessarily that large in most cases, maybe not in every case, depending on the shape of the roof or the pitch of the roof or the trusses. But it was a compliant one-story house when the permit was issued.
Those are all my questions. I'll have comments later.
Our meeting should have been held yesterday for Groundhog's Day, because I feel like this is the same exact application, I don't know, what, 2 or 4 weeks ago. I don't feel like any effort was put forward by the applicant legitimately to really kind of address any of our prior comments. I would just want to replay last meeting's comments and say they still stand. You know, there are tons of ways to articulate and break down the scale of a house from what we have. They don't have to be $80,000 in terms of exposure. There's a lot of, I think, opportunity there with the creative and resourceful mindset. I agree with Commissioner Donahue is that it's about neighborhood privacy, but I think it's also about neighborhood character, scale, and streetscape. And those three items, in addition to privacy, are really what are in question here. And this project has kind of put that into spotlight and really has created a situation, a condition where it's, to me, it's not blight, but it's definitely a visual distraction from the rest of the neighborhood. And I think it's definitely problematic. And I think, you know, the applicant, you know, should be a good neighbor, and look at that and take in consideration how they fit into that, to the context there as a whole. I certainly agree. I think there's just opportunities that just haven't been further investigated. And I'm still of the position and opinion of the conclusions reached by staff are appropriate for this project.
Thank you. Would the applicant like to make a statement or and answer questions from the commissioners? Where is the applicant?
Yes, the applicant would like to make a statement. I'm muting their microphone. Go ahead, Ms. Hudoy. You can unmute your microphone.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, I'm David Elliott. I'm the architect for and applicant for the clients who I came onto this project trying to help them figure out how to keep all that they've done. And none of us are denying that things shouldn't have been built in the attic yet. But I appreciate Dennis Donahue's comment about privacy. And we had discussed this early on about the privacy part, which are the four little dormer windows that are looking in the neighbor's backyards. That's being taken care of. So the only issue that we're discussing now is what the front looks like. And if I could bring your attention to Exhibit I in your packet, that would show you what the project was originally approved of. So the project was ministerial approved as a one-story building with a large attic, and nothing has changed in that consequence other than the things that have been done on the front that I believe do accentuate and the entrance area and does bring some scale down to the height of the overall height. So if you look at Exhibit I, and you can see what was actually approved several years ago and built, and then the consequences of adding the additional work in the front was already accomplished. And so the idea that I had what did set them back, which was the $80,000, Mr. Gonzalez, that was not taking out the stairway. That was taking the entire front of the building and moving it back at the attic area, moving it back about 8 feet. So it was a major change. I mean, they couldn't even live there while they were doing this work. So it was a very consequential change. And I really do appreciate the staff and the commissioners for listening to all the possibilities that we've had. I think the staff has been good to work with. And we feel that this consequence, this last consequence, yes, it was creating, I think, Commissioner Knorr was the one that had talked about doing something in the front and we're allowed to extend into the front setback 5 feet. So that's what we've done. And yes, there are columns, but it does accentuate an entrance. It does accentuate an entrance to the building that more so than it is now. And let's see. Okay, as you can see, Exhibit I there, the lower elevation, that is what was approved. And consequently, the architecture, I think Mr. Gonzalez was asking about, did anything really change? Or Mrs. Bonzo, I think, did. And did anything change? And physically, other than the front entrance, it looks exactly like that. Nothing changed. The mass is all there that was approved. And the consequence of taking advantage of the attic area for some living space, which is merely a sewing room and a music room. That's it. And there's floor plans that show what that is. And then also regarding Megan's comment about structural work that has to be approved with a building permit, we did apply for a building permit. The structural engineer that worked on the original house has looked at that and created engineering that we believe will be no problem with the building department. And so we have that covered as well. So this is physically doable structurally and by the building code. So the only consequence we're looking at is what do we do with the front? And I think it's accentuated adequately.
There are any questions from the commissioners for Mr. Elliott? Commissioner Donahue?
Okay, so if that was approved, this goes back to Commissioner Monzo's question. And so the issue of mass and dimensions is a non-issue, if I understand this correctly. Yes or no?
It's an issue. Am I still on?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's an issue because, as Courtney explained, when you're doing a second story on any house, it requires a use permit.
Right.
Even though this is after the fact, it requires a use permit because the second story is being used. consequent, and that's the time when you look at all the issues of mass and addicts and all those kind of things, and just that just wasn't done a couple of years ago, and it wasn't needed to be to that detail because it was a single story house. But now nothing is really changing. If we just take out the second story use, it's not going to change at all. It's going to be the same.
Well, I certainly agree with Jill, any deliberate thumbing of the nose of the city and flouting that. And, you know, David, I've known you a long time, and that's not your MO, and that's not how you do stuff. But if the fundamental issue of mass and is number one. Number two, I just can't help but pointing out, if the city went out and had the observation, gee, that's a lot of lumber, I just feel like there's a little enabling going on, not directly, but almost reminds me of a situation when I was on the Planning Commission many, many years ago. Best Buy moved into town, and their national color scheme was not approved by the city. And it's like, wait a minute, we're not going to tell a national retailer what color their deal has to be if we want them to come here. And my point is, as I listen to this discussion about cosmetics, who thinks what, that kind of strikes me more of who thinks what. I mean, basically, what you're telling me is we've had a conversation. To Commissioner Norris' point, there was a conversation, there was an effort to move, but when you get to the front, in terms of the cosmetic and how it looks or how it appeals, we just essentially got a difference of opinion. But if I'm a neighbor that all of a sudden's got a second story where I used to, but I'm going to have to deal with it anyway, then to me it's all about privacy. And I'm frankly, because the house clearly is not a one-story house like it used to be. But I mean, when you walk by it, if you're going to have a two-story house, I mean, it looks perfectly fine if you're going to have a second floor. So it just remains kind of thorny to me. But if the mass was always envisioned and understood, I'll just stay with I think the remedy is excessive. But you know, David, the one thing I will say is, you know, if it's technically out of compliance, it's technically out of compliance, and it may have to go to the councils, because that's where I have to be guided as a planning commissioner. Either it is or it is, as opposed to what I happen to think. But I'm uncomfortable that this has gotten this far when mass does not appear to be the issue. I understand all the other stuff, but I don't want to be in a firefight that people need a lot of room because they want to sew and play music. I mean, that's different than an addict, but who's to say that's not living? That's playing, you know, that's playing the piano and sewing, which is, you know, I would define living quarters as that's where your bedrooms are and all that other stuff. So, I mean, it wouldn't be the first different use for an attic besides just storing stuff. So, that's it.
Yeah, so it sounds like the privacy issue is being taken care of by the frosting of the windows. Yes. The mass was the same mass as originally designated by the original plans. The remaining issues, there's the remaining issue of the front facade, and to be able to break that up a bit because it was built too close to the front of the house as opposed to setback, and we were wanting to avoid the demolition and having to move it. So finding a different, and as Commissioner Norr said, that has not been done adequately in terms of fixing the way that the front facade looks. But I understood that there was also the issue of a staircase was built when, as Courtney said, it was originally going to be a hatch. We're here to make sure that there's compliance. And so whatever the next steps are to make sure that's in compliance with the zoning or the permitting, which it sounds like there wasn't a permitting to do that. And so that could be a next step, but just to name that, cause I feel like that part's getting lost. Or I'm asking, is that still an issue? The question of the stair, was a staircase built without permits to create a two-story situation as opposed to an attic?
I could try to respond to that. I think the answer depends on the outcome of the final decision on the conditional use permit. If the conditional use permit is not approved, then the staircase has to come out. If the conditional use permit is approved, then the staircase has to get approved through a building permit process. The trusses, the loads, all of the features that were constructed as part of the second story conversion of the attic would have to go through a city permit review process.
Because I think the issue is that as an attic, you're just storing stuff. You're not going to have, you know, you're not going to have people living there. You don't have the same building and safety codes or the same structural requirements of an attic as you are going to have for habitable space. And so we haven't looked at that because that second story wasn't permitted as habitable space. So we haven't looked at it yet. There might be things, I know Dave indicated that they already looked at that and it could be fine, but we haven't determined that yet. We haven't determined that they won't need to do more in order to make it safe.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Lutz, any questions for Mr. Elliott?
No questions from Mr. Elliott. The only thing I would ask, and following up a little bit on Rosa, is that if it's if this is a music room and a sewing room, if the home was sold, it could easily be, those two rooms could easily be transformed into bedrooms or whatever kind of living space somebody wanted to add on. Is that right?
Yes, I mean the building code does not make a distinction between what what you use your habitable space for. It could be a sewing room, a music room, a bedroom. It's really, is it habitable or not habitable space?
Thank you.
Mr. Monzo, any questions for Mr. Elliott?
I don't have any questions for Mr. Elliott, but this is going to go back to staff. Because it goes back to the same question I was asking, because I understand that part of it is around the privacy and knowing if people will use it as a living space. I mean, many of us that are working from home, we're using our bedrooms as workspace. So it's like we are, we're using spaces that we normally wouldn't spend that much time inside of for really living in there. And so my whole thing with staff is the exhibit I that we looked at seems to have the dimensions for what the bulk looks like, to see how it's being transformed at what level. And so I guess my question is to staff, how that wasn't identified that there'd be this big, massive thing built in the neighborhood. That's why I'm a little confused about that part.
The issue is it's a flaw in the code. And I actually would recommend, regardless of what decision is made here today, that you may consider asking us to go look back at it. Because as Courtney was describing, when you're adding a roof to an existing, or when you're, creating an attic space, increasing your roof pitch in a single story, it's an administrative review process in the code. Because I don't think fairly, when people do that, they might be increasing their roof by a foot or, something very negligible, 18 inches. But in this case, I think it was 10 feet. But the code doesn't make a distinction. And I think that's a flaw with the code and something we probably need to clean up, because you can have a situation now where people are building attics, that are really second stories. And the reason why we have a conditional use permit process for a second story is, I think, as Commissioner Knorr mentioned, the character, the massing. So we have design guidelines that we apply. So it's a flaw in the code. So I don't think it was
that makes a lot more sense, because I know that a lot of the concern is, also from the neighbors, just like the light. From one of the comments, is like there's no more daylight, and so it had it been put in as a permit for something that people would be using more, you know, that you need a lot more height for if you're going to be using it as a living space, or for hobbies, that you really needed to take into account, you know, the impact on the neighborhood, right? The neighbors in itself. So, okay, thank you very much. That's all I have.
Any questions for Mr. Elliott?
No, thank you.
Okay. Myra, are there any questions from the public regarding this item?
No public comment was received for this item.
Okay. Are there any questions or comments from the commissioners to Courtney about this? We'll start with the Commissioner Donahue.
Well, a couple of things. First of all, I simply want to say that, you know, people of goodwill may differ, and I know the city staff. I'm a few years removed, to be conscientious and thorough, and so that's a non-issue here. That having said, you know, I sat up straight when I heard there's a flaw in the code. So that still suggests to me there's a deal to be had here, which is, you know, not the strict constructionist view of how you look at codes. And I'm certainly with Jill. I vacillate that, you know, was there something deliberate? At a minimum, it certainly seems casual. So I remain pretty kind of frustrated by this one. And I know everyone's trying really hard and it's a difficult problem, but, I think the last question I would have is, based on staff's recommendation, you're basically, our role is to just simply say, is it or isn't in code, correct?
Yeah, through the establishment of the findings.
I mean, that's fundamentally the question. I mean, regardless of what I happen to think, is it or is it not in code? And then it's up to, David's a smart guy and he knows where the council is and he knows, I mean, he just got to meet the city manager along with everyone else. And if there's a recourse, great. But I don't see any choice in this role other than to say the findings are it's out of code. It's technically out of code. But Megan, I certainly would agree with you. I would hope at a minimum, you know, because Jill's asking the right questions in terms of continuity, and there's going to be a lot more of this, and housing prices are going to go nuts, and, you know, crystal ball. So now is the time to address this. That's for darn sure. So I hope this prompts that. But, when I vote, I mean, I'm just going to reinforce this as staff's findings, but just a tough one. Don't feel good about it, but I feel good that the applicant has some places to go with this, and because I'd encourage him to do it.
So, any questions of Courtney?
Chairperson Meeks, could I make a quick question or ask a question? When we asked Myra, if there are any comments from the public regarding this item, it looks like someone has their hand up on the applicant side, and I'm not sure if we thoroughly covered the public hearing portion. I just want to make sure from a due process standpoint, we cover the public hearing part of this item.
Myra, would you bring them in?
The person that has their hand up is David Elliott. I thought it was Elliot Kudelank, but it's David. Did I open it again?
Yeah.
The hand is still up, and I'm not sure if.
I think it would be advisable to allow.
Mr. Elliott?
Yeah, thanks again. I think the owner, Eduardo, would like to speak about what his intents were. I mean, I wasn't the original architect. He built this. It's a beautiful home inside and out. And he has some comments, if you would.
Well, what I want to say to you guys is, first of all, First of all, how you doing, everybody? And second, I want to say, I never intend to do this. Megan and other people know me for many years. And also, I tried to working with the stairs a long time ago, but my instruments and everything is not working in the little stairs where I got to walking upstairs. That is the reason to I proposed to the city long time ago to put the stairs, and the stairs denied, the city denied so many times my application. And Megan and Courtney know. So that is the reason to, I know it's my fault to put that stairs, but I don't do it in purpose or already got that idea. What happened is my instruments is no work, no way no, to, don't fit in the stairs.
It's music instruments.
And the point is, Megan, Courtney have a lot of times meetings with me in the city when I build the new togos in Monterey Street. And you guys approve things to other people with no permits, and you don't want to help me. I don't know why. I'm a contractor, and I try to help all the time. Megan, you and Courtney, all the time when you ask me something, I do. I never got any complaint in anything. I do whatever you want me to do, because you are the law, and I follow the law. But in this time, I don't see the way to you guys that don't let me approve my this thing. The first of all, I want to say the stairs, I build it. And the windows is not for rooms, it's for my music room. The windows is small, it's not the code for bedrooms. The size for the places is not for bedrooms, it's small. You guys approved my house many years ago. The whole entry and everything. Now you try to cut half of the roof. Half of the roof, remove half of the roof of the house to change the facade. Things like that is what's going on right here. Why the city don't working with me? Why? And what he working with other people with no permits and everything, approved things. It's not right. I feel you frustrated, really frustrated, because I'm paying my taxes, everything what I need to do to help the city, including I help the city to help with the homeless, to do it the all kind of help, not only right now with the new lawyer is in the city. When Vanessa is here, ask Vanessa. I'm working with the city for everything. And you guys going against me for, I'm not sure what is the reason, but I'm really frustrated for this. Because I'm agreed to do the...
Thank you, Mr. Kudelink. The chairperson has called the time.
I forgot where we were, who was talking last.
I think it was to me, and I did not have questions.
Okay. Commissioner.
I'm sorry, Chair, was that directed to me?
Yeah, did you have any questions for Courtney?
No, I don't have any further questions for Courtney.
Okay. Then
I don't know if we skipped Commissioner Lutz. I don't know. Sorry.
Okay.
Thanks, John. I actually, the only question is that, and I sure feel all of our frustration, including the applicant. Courtney, if we deny the conditional use permit based on the findings that that staff has presented, that the project does not meet zoning code requirements, we assume that the applicant can appeal to the council. Is that correct?
That's correct. All planning commission decisions can be appealed to the city council.
Okay, and then the second question is, would you recommend that we make as part of our motion that somehow that, you know, that they, we refer back to staff, that they go back and look at this code and figure out, fix the problems, because there are problems, obviously.
Yes, the zoning standards for a one-story addition are different for a two-story addition. I think that needs attention.
Okay, good. Thank you.
And before I ask for a motion, I would like Courtney to clarify that if a vote for yes would be denying the permit, correct? A vote no would be allowing it.
I think it depends on the motion. So I think once we get a motion, I think that answer will come forward.
Okay. And that question, do we have a motion for a motion on item 21-041 from the commission?
John?
Yes.
I would like to make a motion to deny the conditional use permit, affirm the finding of staff that the project does not meet the zoning code requirements, and that we send this back to staff to look at our zoning codes.
Do we have a second?
A second.
Okay. Was motion by Commissioner Lutz and a second by Commissioner Knorr. Do we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Donahue?
Yes.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Yes.
Commissioner Lutz?
Aye.
Commissioner Monzo?
Aye.
Commissioner Knorr?
Yes.
Chairperson Mee?
Yes. So, the conditional use permit 2020-001, conditional use permit request for residential design room to convert.
Commissioner Meeks, I'm sorry.
Square feet, you know.
Chairperson Meeks?
May I make a suggestion? Because the chairperson is breaking up quite a bit. Maybe it would be okay if Myra read out the statement. I don't know, Courtney, if that's okay.
I think that would work. I'm not sure why, but sometimes Chairperson Meek sounds fine, and then other times it gets really, really blurry.
The conditional use permit 2020-001 request for residential design review to convert 965 square feet of an existing
1099
attic into a second story addition family dwelling unit located at 1054 University Avenue in the R-L-5.5 residential low density zoning district. The planning commission has just motion to deny.
I think we might have lost our chair. Maybe he's disconnecting and reconnecting to have better sound.
Well, Megan, since you stepped into the breach, I'm gonna view you as the chair. With your permission, could I say one final thing to the applicant?
Actually, we have a vice chair.
Okay,
and
I'm here now.
You're back. Okay.
He's back. Great.
All right. Good.
So, how far did we get in the process of reading the conditional use permit?
Myra was able to read it. Chris, do you think there's a need to read? Was it okay with
Megan? No, I think it's fine that Myra read.
She was able to read.
Yes, Myra was able to read it, so we have it in the record. The one thing that was missing was the notice of the right to appeal within 10 days from the Planning Commission's decision, right, which just occurred. And so that's the last notice. And then Chair Meeks. Chair Meeks, Commissioner Donahue had a question or a comment that he wanted to make. And that's when you came back on.
Yes, Commissioner Donahue.
Yeah, just very quickly, and Chris, thanks for adding that. I want to encourage the applicant to do that. And I also want the applicant to recognize that, you know, this is a good group of folks that tried really, really, really hard. But at the end of the day, to some degree, the code's the code, and either in or out. But that doesn't mean you can't exhaust this. And, you know, you've got a great architect. And very, very frankly, if I were sitting on the council, I would want this to come to us, because it does speak to a lot of other things. So even though you may be a little discouraged and none of this is easy, this is now going to go where it should be, in my opinion, because it does speak to a flawed code at an important time in the history for a lot of other reasons that don't pertain to you. But it's, and frankly, I'm sorry you're, I mean, no fun to be part of history this way, but it's really important that the city does take a look at this. The only thing I will feel bad is having sat at the dais, and sometimes something looks really simple and you have a mental picture of how long things are going to take.
Okay.
New city manager, trust me when I tell you, tell them not to plan on 10 minutes on this one, because this is a tricky one. But I want to assure the applicant, this is where it should be, really, and I really am impressed how hard everyone's tried. But at the end, we have no choice but to do the technically right, as far as this body, in my view. So I just wanted to encourage you to appeal, and Chris, thanks for bringing that up.
Okay, let me read the last part of this. The request for a conditional use permit has been denied. Any person having standing to do so under the law who is aggrieved by this action or decision may file an appeal within 10 days with the Community Development Department located at 65 West Alisal Street. Moving on. Conditional use permit 2020-002, which is a construction of a stealthy telecommunications facility, has been continued till February the 17th Planning Commission meeting. Other business, Courtney.
Other business, I do have one item. My understanding is that there is an effort to resume Planning Commission meetings back in the City Council Rotunda. This appears to be optional. Seating will be limited to 10 persons, including city staff. The CDC guidelines for safety must be followed, which include face masks and social distancing. Applicants and the public will continue to attend a Zoom webinar. In other words, no in-person public comments will be permitted at the rotunda. So what that means is anyone interested in going to the rotunda at our next Planning Commission meeting?
You have to keep your mask up when you talk?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yep, the answer is yes.
Good. I like remote.
I am.
So hearing no takers, that is the only other business item I have. There may be others.
Okay, follow-up reports?
I don't have any follow-up reports.
Courtney, I don't know if you wanted to mention quickly about the general plan presentation coming.
Sure. I was going to handle that in future agenda
items. Oh, okay. Please do. I'm sorry. I forgot about that in the agenda.
No worries.
Okay. Future agenda items.
Yes. The General Plan Update Steering Committee. We mentioned this a little while back, I think at the last Planning Commission meeting. One of the planning commissioners is being requested to sit on the steering committee. At our next meeting on the 17th, we will have a presentation, I believe a PowerPoint, by Lisa Brenton, planning manager for for the general plan update. And at the end of that presentation, the city staff will be looking for a volunteer or some nominations of commissioners, depending how many commissioners are interested. And we will try to get somebody tapped on the shoulder for that important job.
And I think what we wanted to do is to give you each time to think it through after the presentation. So we wouldn't actually need the selected person until the following meeting. But that would give you a little time to put forward a statement maybe of, you know, why you want to be on the committee. If there's more than one person, if there's only one person, that's great. That makes it easy.
Okay. Thank you. Any other future agenda items?
Yes, we plan to bring back the item you just mentioned, Chair Meeks, the major telecom on 17 Navajo. We're still having trouble getting a hold of the applicant and Verizon, and we're not sure if we'll get much progress on that before the 17th, but we will have to make a decision on that item on the 17th. We also have a residential design review, similar to the project we just spoke about on University. It's a new two-story home from the ground up. This one is not built yet. It's on 37 Pine Street. That's coming forward. And I think we have a parcel map in the future growth area coming forward. And that'll be one of the first steps in future growth area residential subdivision development, where the larger acreages are being broken down into smaller, more manageable chunks for the future submittal of tentative maps and subdivisions. And okay. That's it.
Okay. Next regular scheduled meeting is on the 17th of February, the year 2021. Can I have an idea of who will be able to attend? Just raise your hand or... One, two, three. Okay, thank you. Given all that, the meeting is adjourned, and thank you for putting up with my loss of internet connection there. Have a good evening, everyone. Stay safe.
Thank you.
Thanks, Sean. Okay.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay. See you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye.